without spot to God. Purge you, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God.
Amen.
In chapter 10, it says in verse 3, but in those sacrifices there's a remembering again of sins every year. For it is not possible that the blood of bulls and goats should take away sin. It was never enough. That old wine was never going to be enough. It was always going to leave you short. It was always going to leave you in want. It was never going to make it. Hear me this morning, but verse 12 in chapter 10 says, but this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down on the right hand of God. Verse 14, for by one offering he hath perfected forever them that are sanctified, and their sins and iniquities. Verse 17, will I remember no more. Amen. Oh, I love that. Did you hear that this morning? He said, I'll remember their sins and iniquities no more. Amen. And I told you earlier, this is what baptism is. It is a place where we wash away the old past, a place where God closes that chapter. Yes, you and I still may remember, but God says, I won't remember. I don't want to remember. I choose to forget what you still might remember. Amen. And what the devil will certainly still accuse you of. I choose to forget.
Amen.
It says now in verse 18, where remission of these is, there is no more offering for sin. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Verse 22 says, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. I read all that because this is what he's dealing with. He said the Old Testament wine was never enough. Did you catch what I just read for you in that last verse in 22? He's been dealing with the blood from chapter 9 all the way through chapter 10. And then we get to this verse and he says water. Now hold on a minute. Pastor, are we washed by the water or are we washed by the blood? Listen. The blood, what can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood. This water is a cleansing agent. But it's not the saving agent. The blood brought your redemption.
Amen.
This is symbolic of the Holy Spirit. In verse 6 here, back into our chapter there in Luke, verse 6 says, there were six water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. There were 6 water pots of stone. That word stone there literally means hardened clay. That's what the original language meant. There are 6 water pots of clay sitting there, and they're all half empty. 6 is the number of man throughout your Bible. If you remember what Genesis says, God took dust of the earth. He formed and fashioned man from clay of the earth. So you and I are imperfect. These vessels that sit there half empty, all of your life you will be in want. But you know the beauty of this? He says, know ye not that you are the temple of the Most High? You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. See, the water, he said, the blood and the water, this is where they overlap. The Holy Spirit, you were created, you were designed, flaws and all. You would think if you were going to put precious treasure in something, you would choose anything but dirt. If I were going to store something that valuable, I would maybe make a pitcher or something out of gold or something more precious than just dirt. But God chose you. He chose you and I. We're the number of man, every man, it wasn't that some of the vessels were full and some were empty. No, listen. He said, that living water, I want to fill you up. It's not my desire that you would ever be in life, but I've come to fill you up. I created you. I designed you. I formed you and fashioned you that you might be the dwelling place of the Holy Spirit, never to go through life half empty.
Yes.
In this morning, church, the reality is every man, every woman, every one of those pictures sat on the wall in lack. Every one of them had not enough. But Jesus came and said, fill them. He could have said, just fill one up. How many of you know that all he had to do is snap his fingers and he could have just made wine? He didn't even need these pictures. He certainly didn't need to bring water into the picture at all. He could have just said, pour the wine into it. Like the widow woman with the oil. He could have said pour and it would have been wine and came out, but that's not at all what he chose to do. Why? Because I'm telling you, in the very beginning, that first miracle, he was painting a picture out for you and I to see what the end was going to look like. This living water, he desired to fill every one of those. He desires to fill you and I with the Holy Spirit today so that Amen. You won't come in church half empty anymore. Yes. God's desire is to so fill you up that you would know beyond a shadow of a doubt, that you would know from the inside out the reality of his presence.
Yes. Amen.
It really grieves my spirit to see how many Christians come in and they're like the man that I opened up with. They come to church and they're a good person, but they're not changed. I'm absolutely convinced that no man, woman, or child can have a divine encounter with God and ever be the same.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
You will be changed. You will be transformed when he fills you up. All the way the Bible said he filled him up to the brim.
Yes.
When he fills you up, you'll be like Saul. There'll be something on the inside that compels you to look different on the outside. Mm-hmm. But there's too many people, listen, they come to church, but they don't look any different. Their weekend routine has changed, and that's all. There's some people that's gotten more involved and they come every time the doors are open and they put something in the plate and they help out with almost anything that there's need. But if you follow them home, they don't look any different than they did when they started coming. Just their hobbies have changed. Hear me this morning. God's desire is not for you to be a half empty no matter where you're sitting, whether it's in the church or the bar stool.
Amen. Amen. That's good.
He said to them, fill them up. When they begin, listen, Jesus said to them, fill the pots with water. With water. And they filled them up to the brim. And then verse 8, he said to them, draw out now. Draw out now and bear them to the governor of the feast, and they bear it. Draw out now and bear it to the governor. The governor is the master. The governor is the Lord. The governor is the king in the picture here. He said, draw out that water now and take it to the master. And they obeyed. And verse 9 to 10 says, and when the ruler of the feast, when the king had tasted the water that was made wine, he knew not where it came from, but the servants which drew the water still knew. And the governor of the feast called the bridegroom. He said to him, every man at the beginning sets forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse. But you have kept the good wine until now. Oh, this is getting good. Listen. In this picture, she's pleading for all the people. They don't have wine. I assure you, the king had wine. If he wanted wine, the king had wine. Are you with me this morning? He hasn't run out of wine. His guests may have run out of wine. They may not have what they need, but I've got access to whatever I want and whatever I need. But it's interesting. He said, draw out now and take it to the master. Take it to the king. And when he took it to the king took a sip of that wine. He didn't know where it came from, even though the servants still knew. Let me break this down. He didn't know where you came from, but you still know. He's chosen to forget what you still remember. The king didn't ask where it came from, didn't ask about his past. He chose to accept it just like it is. Said, this is far better than anything I've ever had. And I love the fact that he called the bridegroom. And don't miss this. The king is the one throwing this great feast. The king is throwing a party because his son is getting married. The bridegroom is the son of the king. Do you not know the Father has a son? His name is Jesus Christ. Do you not know that Jesus is the bridegroom? He's coming back for his bride, which
yes.
happens to be
Amen.
The church. Amen. Without spot, without blemish. The Father tasted this wine. He calls the bridegroom, and the bridegroom gets credit for this wine. Who did this miracle? In the literal picture that we saw. Jesus, right? But the king, because this is not a parable, the king called his son. The king called his son and gave the son credit. Because I'm telling you, this picture is bigger than what you see on the surface. Who was the son that got the credit? It was Jesus Christ. When he tasted of that, he took no thought of where it came from, though the servants still knew every piece of baggage and bondage that brought them in. But when they drew the water out, they didn't draw wine out, they drew the water out. All they ever saw was water. But when the king tasted the water, that's not at all what he tasted. What he tasted was wine. He called the son and said, this thing is far better than that old sacrifice. This is far better than the blood of goats and sheep. I'm telling you this morning, what you may see when you dip yourself in that Jordan River or in that Lake Murray might look like just water, but I'm telling you what God sees. It's not water that's dripping from your hair. It's not water that's dripping down your toes. It's the blood of the spotless lamb, Jesus Christ. In the very beginning, he was painting a picture of the end. He said, you might have only saw water because the hour's not yet come, but if you go ahead and obey what I've told you to do in the now, I'll make provision in the now, so that when you're drawn out, hear me this morning, I'm looking forward, there's coming a day, and it's probably sooner than I might think, where he's going to draw me out and say to the servant, draw out, mark, trumpet, and present him to the master. Oh, I'm looking forward to that day. But it says, well done, good and faithful servant. Amen. See, I still remember, but the master, all he sees is the love, the wine, glory, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you, Lord.
Stay with me all over the house.